Hi, this is Dr. Gloria Frost of the University of St. Thomas. In this short video animation, I'm going to provide you with a brief summary of Immanuel Kant's ethical theory and its approach to evaluating actions. Kant's theory is a deontological theory of ethics. The word deon means duty in Greek. Deontological theories judge actions to be right or wrong based on whether they conform with our duties. For Kant, what is most important in life is having a good will. A good will wills actions that conform to one's duty solely because it's one's duty to do so. This means that there are two elements to having a good will. First, the actions that are chosen by a person must be the right kind of actions. They are actions that conform to the duties which are set by the moral law. Second, a person must choose the right action solely because it is the right thing to do. This is to say that he or she must have the right motive. The person with a good will does not do right actions because he or she fears punishment or hopes for a reward. He or she does the right thing just because it's the right thing to do. Kant came up with two different tests for how we can tell whether a given action is in accord with duty or fits with the moral law. His test, called the categorical imperative, states, "I should never act except in such a way that I can also will that my maxim should become a universal law." Kant says that we need to ask ourselves whether we could will to live in a world where every other person acted according to the principle we are about to act on. For instance, when a student is considering cheating on an important test because he didn't study, he should ask himself, according to Kant, "Would I want to live in a world where everyone everywhere always cheated when they were taking an exam they didn't prepare for?" It seems that this would be an undesirable world. For example, grades would not be able to be trusted, and academic honors would be meaningless. Since universalizing the maxim or principle that one should cheat when one is unprepared leads to difficulties, we can know that acting on this principle violates the moral duty and the moral law. Kant believed that in addition to this first test, there was another way to test whether a given action is in accord with or a violation of our moral duty. Kant formulates this test as follows. "Act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own person or in the person of another, always at the same time as an end and never simply as a means." In Kant's view, human beings have infinite intrinsic value because we are rational beings. Each person is capable of formulating their own purposes and goals. When we act towards other persons, we need to remember that each person has hopes, dreams, goals, plans, and desires just like we do. We cannot reduce other people to mere objects for fulfilling our own plans. The worth and value of human beings, human persons that is, comes solely from what they are, not because of any utility or job they do for someone else. Any act that involves using another person or even oneself as a means, without also respecting the person as an end, counts as an act which violates the moral law and one's duty. So in conclusion, if we want to know whether Kant would think a certain action is morally good action, there are two important distinctions we need to keep in mind. First, we must consider the action itself and determine whether or not it fits with the duty all of us have to follow the moral law. We can use the two tests we learned about regarding the universability of maxims and treating humanity as an end to know whether a given act lines up with the moral law and duty. Second, we must consider the agent's motive to know if their act has moral worth. For Kant, the only actions that have true moral worth are those which are done from duty because they are right. Actions done from some ulterior motive, such as pleasure or fear of punishment, do not have true moral worth, according to Kant.